All right, guys, I'm kind of buzzed right now, so we're just gonna let it roll. No editing. Went to an open mic night that my friend was hosting. Got to play, be supportive. It was killer. So, trying to hold back on the vinyl. All this good shit comes out. It's hilarious. So, I'm gonna try to just show you all the stuff I got, and I'm trying to hold back. And I'm sure you can all relate. So, super stoked to finally get a copy of Show of Hands. I woke up the other morning hearing Distant Early Warning in my head. For some of you, that could be like, that sucks. But for us Rush fans, that's great. And I went to my collection to go find the album with that song, and I don't even have the album, apparently. So I was like, I know I have a live album with at least that song. And no, double bummer. So, went to my local spot to try to find Grace Under Pressure. They didn't have it, but they had Show of Hands. And I had this on cassette tape when I was a little kid. Don't have that copy anymore, but stoked to finally get this on vinyl. Sounds killer. And it's remastered. It's for Hold Your Fire. It was for, they took those recordings from two different tours. I think one of them was Hold Your Fire and something else. I think Grace Under Pressure. I could be wrong. So, anyways, what else did I get? Okay, I might have. So, I got one of these. The second song kind of had a popping sound for a good, like, from the middle of the song all the way to the end. Went and got a different copy. Same scenario. I think it was worse. So, I went and just got my money back for the album, or store credit. Picked up a Tone Poet. I tried to find one of these online. I couldn't find one for a decent fucking deal. So I went there and they only had two left. And this one, still a pop on the second song, but not as long and not as noticeable. So it's, and you're my age, this album, when it came out, I didn't try to get the whole album, but the song, I'm a Loser, or Loser, was on MTV and it was like, even if you didn't become a Beck fan, you're like, this song's pretty badass. And somehow we ended up getting the CD from one of my friends, and we would just put it on as like almost a novelty. Like, we got this fucking, this album's really weird. And so it just brings back memories of my youth a little bit, being a fucking dumbass teenager. And so, fuck it, I got a pink copy, and it doesn't have the best sound, but I mean, I'm not the biggest Beck fan, and I'd rather have at least a copy than no copy. So, right on, right on. And it's on pink swirl. So, I finally have all of White Zombie's albums. They have seven albums, just White Zombie. You're probably thinking, I thought they only had two, because that's what I thought for a long time when I was younger. Until they came out with this box set back in 2008. And that's when I realized, well, there's a bunch of other fucking White Zombie besides Le Sexorcisto and Astro Creep 2000, which when this album came out, it was like, this was the segue to Rob Zombie. This album, I was like, ugh, this. I enjoy it now, but when it came out, I was like, oh, that fucking sucks compared to Le Sexorcisto, because that album was so fucking good. So, but don't have it. Finally got his copy of this. And like I said, I have the box set, which has their first five albums. And then I have two copies of Le Sexorcisto. And then I finally completed it. And haven't even played this one yet, but maybe I will later tonight. If not tonight, for sure tomorrow it's going down. Okay. Let's go to CDs for a second. You know, let's talk about CDs. I might have shown this one, and I can't remember if I did or not, but I scored Porno for Pyros. It's a singer from Jane's Addiction, Perry Farewell, the dude who did the Lollapalooza tour. It says $4. I got this for 50 cents. The guy apparently has a shit ton of CDs, and he was doing a sale. 50 cents a CD, and I was like, really? All the CDs that have a blue mark. Blue mark sell. And, scored this and a couple other CDs. Anyways, I scored some other one. I know it was like a Dire Straits, but there was another good one with a girl singer. Anyways, I can't remember. It wasn't the Breeders. Anyways, got this album. Porno for Pyros only did two albums, I'm pretty sure. But this is the song with the album. Or the song with the album. This is the album with the song, Pets. We make great pets. We make great pets. It was a little bit annoying when it came out, but it, you're like, that's pretty fucking stony. The video is pretty trippy. And I don't think I've ever had a copy of this album. I had a downloaded copy on my iPod, but I have never owned a physical CD. So yeah. I swear I only had like a couple drinks and I'm fucking buzzed. It's hilarious. Oh wait, I did a shot too. Gosh damn, that's weird how that happens. Anyways, it's mind-boggling. There's definitely parallel universes. Okay, so a couple cassette tapes I got recently. So I scored this, Blood and Arms, a while back. It was $2. I don't have it on cassette tape. Why not complete the trio? CD, cassette tape, vinyl. It's sad that that's what it's come to. It's just, that's all my life revolves around, I guess. Sade. Don't have this on CD, but I have it on vinyl. And I have a few copies on vinyl. And now one on cassette tape. This is so old school that it's not even in the clear. It's and a lot of the 80s cassette tapes seems like were this. When I was a kid, I thought these were like, I liked the clear ones. For instance, the way these ones looked. This is your standard ones for the longest time, I feel like. Well, yeah. All my cassette tapes were like this. Most of my cassette tapes were like this when I was a kid. All right. VHS. I'm going to fucking segue here. And that was no segue, but we're going to make a segue. Fucking Black Rain on VHS. Steel sealed. Now, I opened it earlier because I'm watching it. And I'm more than halfway. This is one of my favorite cop movies. Now, 90s cop movies. I'm a huge movie person. Fucking every genre you can think of. Just how I listen to a lot of music. Different genres of music. Similar to movies. My first love, though, was horror movies. That was like crack about horror movies when I was a kid. Even into my early 20s, I watched other genres of movies, but 80% of the time it was horror. And then something in my mid-20s, I just started watching a lot more comedy. Even though I was already into comedy, it was like there just wasn't that much new horror. I had already seen most of my horror movies, and there wasn't any new good stuff really coming out to blow my mind. So I was still just rewatching a lot of old stuff. So I think there was a lot more new comedy that was coming out that was outweighing the horror movies. So anyways, 90s cop movies, though. I went through a phase where I feel like that's, you know, like even though I'm a musician, like, if, you know what I mean? I come home, I feel like, you know, fucking gnarly ass case I'm trying to solve, but it's just music, you know. But I like, you know, the detective on the case approach. No? Anybody, no one else thinks they're fucking Jesse Stone? Am I the only one? Fuck it. All right. So I just want to, maybe some of you younger people don't know. I mean, back in the day, this, like, if you wanted people to be intimidated or the women to come to you, this is like what you needed to be back in the 90s. Now, let's fucking, okay, let's start from the top. Fucking mullet, fucking hairdo. Okay, I don't got it right now, but back in the day, that's what you needed. Check. What else do you notice here? Fucking sunglasses. Fucking big old, but like, you can't just wear those with thinking you can just put them on. You gotta commit. Okay, turtleneck with a leather jacket. That's kind of rare to pull that combo off, but is it Michael Douglas? Yeah, he was that fucking courageous. Now, not only when you were a cop back in the 90s, you had to have a motorcycle. And not only did you have a motorcycle, you had to fucking, in the early morning, you would go race motherfuckers and smoke their asses, do a little gambling, collect that little debt, right, money you need to fucking pay off. So anyways, and if you haven't seen this movie, it's fucking epic. It's basically, he goes to Japan because this dude he's trying to take over there, totally pulls a fast one on him with his crew, shows him some fake paperwork, sneaks him away, goes to the front of the plane, and like, fuck, we got faked out. So Michael Douglas being so passionate of a cop. He's like, fuck you, Andy Garcia. We're not going back. We are going to fucking hunt this motherfucker down because it's our case. We brought him here. We fucked up. We got to finish the job. He's that. He don't want to. And Andy Garcia's like, what if I get beheaded? Chopped off fucking ninja sword. And he's like, calm it down. You know what I mean? Now, they get there. Can't spoiler, but maybe Andy Garcia does get fucking shink. Okay, so then he's out there in Japan, but he needs a helper. Who's his helper? I'm going to forget his name. But they call him Moss. It's like, because short, because part of his name. And it's like, Moss is kind of intimidated. Like, he's kind of shy. The way he does, he's not trying to break the rules as a cop out there. And Michael Douglas is like, stop being a fucking bitch. Do you want to be a fucking badass, or do you want to be the bitch cop? And the dude's finally like, fuck, I want to be the badass. And so he's like, all right, get the turtleneck, get the glasses, get the leather coat, let's fucking do this. And he takes them on a journey. And then they become BFFs. It's like, it's kind of a bromance now that I think about it. But it's like, you get teary-eyed at the end. I mean, every time I watch this movie, it hits way harder than Bambi. So, Black Rain, I had to talk about it. It's halfway through right now. After I get done, I'm going to watch this. And that was pretty cool because I have to use this old TV for my VCR to work. I got surround sound, old school style. Just run the auxiliary cord into the headphones. I can't even say auxiliary right now, but fuck it. All right, what else did I get? Sausage. Not the breakfast. Okay, fucking the band. What is Sausage? That's basically Primus. Now, Primus originally was Primate with Jay Lane and this guitar player. I should know his name, but I don't. Anyways, this other guitar player who's really badass, they did this band. Then the guitar player had a kid, and was married. And before they started Sausage, when Primus was Primate, the dude had kids, fucking left the band. That's when Larry Lalonde filled in, and they changed it from Primate to Primus. And Primate's first demo was called Sausage, I believe, if the story goes right, if I remember correctly. And so Primus gets big time. They're still all homies. They put the band back together, the original Primus, basically. They can't call it Primus because Primus is already fucking big time with contracts. So they put this together. What to call it? They call it what the first demo was called, Sausage. So this album, Riddles Are Abound, is super badass. And it basically sounds like 90s Primus. This is almost like the lost Primus album because it fits in perfectly to where right after before Pork Soda. So it's like if this came out before Pork Soda, I feel like. I could be wrong on that one, though. But there was one of the songs on Beavis and Butthead, where Beavis and Butthead are just totally ripping on it because it's Primus and the video was so strange. And but it has the Toys Go Winding Down Part 2. It's not called. It's called Toys 1988. But when I was younger, I just felt like it was the Toys Go Winding Down Part 2. The song Prelude to Fear, which is opening track, super killer. Anyways, I was able to, I have a copy of this. Mine is super beat down that it plays luckily on my CD player, but there's sometimes certain CD players it doesn't work on because it's just charred on the bottom. It wasn't one of those CDs I bought. It was a friend somehow ended up with a damn CD. And so anyways, got a pristine mint copy. Super stoked to be placed tomorrow. I haven't even played it yet. I have the beat up one in my CD player right now though because I started thinking about it. I was like, oh, I want to hear some Sausage. And I was like, I need a better copy because I didn't even have the case. So it's cool that I got the case and my CD. So, okay, the grand finale. And I'm probably like, this is going to go on YouTube. I don't give a shit. But obviously, I'm like, and I'm pretty sure I had 2 beers and a shot. I'm thinking like I'm tanked. But, gosh, man, just rough. Okay, totally kidding. The grand finale. I wasn't planning on getting this, but then it came out, and I was like, I don't have any of this person's, not one album. So usually I don't want to go straight to the box set if I don't have one album, because I mean, why am, if I don't have one album, how am I going to like all a fucking box set? But I looked and seen what albums were in this box set, listened, gave a little preview, and I was like, oh shit, sounds like I'm going to like it. So what is that? I went to my spot, and I figured there was a possibility they might have this damn box set, and everybody already knows. Yes, the Ornette Coleman one. Again, trying to hold back, not even get this one, and it's still in the plastic. I'm kind of cherishing, like, okay, just have a cool box set, it's still in the plastic. I figured, fuck it, it's the first Tone Poet series box set. This one, for the price, it's about almost dead even what you would pay for fucking six albums solo. So that was what I'm surprised it's not more, but I'm disappointed it's not less. Does that make any sense? Where I could have seen this been like at $300 because it's the Tone Poet series. And just them upping the price in general because it's their first box set. But they kept it pretty much exactly what it would cost to pay for six albums. So you're getting almost a box as a bonus, I feel like. And then you do get a, it looks like you get a little thing with some pictures in there. So, and I haven't even opened this thing. It looks like they're all in good condition. I don't want to open this. I'm sure you guys already know it's about. Probably some of you already, obviously some of you guys have this already. I watched a 45 RPM audio file. I show his. Go check his channel out. It's a great channel. All right, so what's up? Six albums. And it's mastered by Kevin Gray. All that good stuff. I mean, this is a heavy box set. Okay, I better be careful. I don't want to drop this while I'm on camera. I don't want to drop it in general, but on camera. If I'm going to drop it, it's best to be filmed so you can hear me like cuss and stuff. But it's mastered by Kevin Gray at Coherent Audio. Anyways, mastered from the original analog tapes. I don't even know what that means anymore. Okay, so what's up? I'm gonna get my Coleman groove on. It looks nice. And it's got a... Here, I'll just tell you guys which albums. If you're still watching this horrible episode, thank you. You guys are awesome. Okay, Ornette Coleman Trio, The Golden Circle, Stockholm Volume 1, Golden Circles, or Golden Circle, Stockholm Volume 2, The Empty Foxhole, New and Old Gospel, with Jackie McLean. That's going to be interesting. New York Is Now, and then Love Call. So, fuck yeah. Stoked. All right. So, Ben, we're all busy in the realm, but been extra busy with the music, which I've been trying to. I want to make sure I'm more busy every year. And so, yesterday, this one outdoor venue sent me a text message. Hey, can your blues band, or you, either one, whatever's available, whatever you know, my bass player was not available, so I was like, oh, well, it's going to be solo. Went and did a 3-hour set, super awesome, because I think I was just going to go street perform, because it was going to be warm enough. And then the night before that, I got to play at Gumbo's. It's a restaurant, it has like an upstairs bar. It's like a restaurant with a little bar. They have a tiny, little, tiny stage. It can barely fit like maybe three people, but just me by myself. But I love playing there. It's got a cool balcony, really good view, watching the sunset. And then, no gigs tonight. Went to this open mic night though. And then tomorrow, my blues band's playing at a residency spot we go to every other Sunday. And so, anyways, and then I'm playing on Valentine's Day. A private event that some people see me street performing, like what they heard, grabbed a card, and then contacted me to play this for Valentine's Day for a handful of couples. I think they said 8 couples, so maybe like 16 people, so, something along the lines of that. And they said they're going to have a private chef there making sushi or something. So, anyways, they hired me for 4 hours, so I'm going to be playing for a while. All right, my phone's dying. I've been talking for way too long. You guys are awesome. Stay positive. Play lots of vinyl. If you got any of these albums, throw a comment. And if you're a fan of Black Ring, throw a comment. Later.